So, Vít, are you here with us? So now we
Hi.
So I made you a co-host, so you should have no problem with sharing screen and everything.
Yeah.
So well, but first, just let me say a few words. Vít, he's working at the Institute of Philosophy of the Czech Academy of Sciences. He has been doing work both in philosophy and in linguistics. He has written about the history of Czech semiotics and the semiotics of Peirce, and also Jakobson's theories. So his talk today will be called General Semiotics and Token Models, the Case of Simulation and Emulation. So yes, please.
Yeah, thank you. It's nice to see you all, and it's a great pleasure to be with you all and here. And I think it's more than appropriate to start with a thank you. And the biggest thank you goes to Israel for organizing this series. Wonderful speakers, and everything's wonderful. And welcome. Minor thanks goes to Tyler Bennett. It's just a personal thanks. So I'm gonna share my slides. One minute. Oh. So, no, sorry for that. So, can you see me? Can you tell me what you see?
Yes, we see your screen and with your slides, the presentation.
Yeah, General Semiotics and Token Models, the Case of Simulation and Emulation, right?
Yes, but we don't see it in full screen, though.
Okay.
So you should just start the presentation and it will be perfect. Yes.
Yeah, because I'm sort of it's in full screen, so yeah. So what now?
Okay, it's good.
It's good? Okay,
yeah.
Cool. Listening to Jeremy's talk and the great discussion after that, I'm not really sure how I fit in with my approach, because it's a sort of a engineering approach. In one sense, it's more general. In other sense, it's like a more specific. So we'll see. And I'm gonna be talking about these sort of three things: general semiotics, token models, and these terms, simulation and emulation. So when my presentation is divided into three parts. The first is sort of a first context, the much broader context, which I call background or framework. And it's a sort of a specific historical context. As Israel mentioned, I have this book on history of Czech semiotics, and this will be it. The second part is about this guy Ivo Osolsobě and his approach to general semiotics, and his idea about let's say models and science, and specifically about token models and what is it, what it isn't, and how does it fit in more general, let's say, semiotic layout. And this work, this is a sort of a second context, much more narrow. And I wanna, yeah?
Sorry, we have a problem because your slides are not moving.
Are not moving?
Oh, yeah, so we just see the first slide.
Okay.
Okay, now we see the second slide, yes.
Yeah, now you can see the second slide, is it right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it out? And now you can see the third slide or no?
No.
The third, no. Well. that's absolutely wonderful. So we'll see. I'll try to manage it somehow. So the third part will be can be seen as a sort of an application of the of this more narrow context of what Ivo Osolsobě and thinks about general semiotics and token models. So maybe I guess I will just a brief moment. So, yeah. Can you see now the third slide, Czech theory?
No, we are still in the second one.
Okay.
Now, there we can see it. Yes.
That's.
Now we can see the third one.
That's straight. Yes. So, sorry for that. So, the sort of a background and framework in which I'm gonna sort of operate comes from the book called Czech Theory. I published a few years ago, and which I focused on semiotics in the Czech Republic and Czechoslovakia in the sort of a second half of the 20th century and the first 15 years of the 21st century. And it's a great pleasure to mention here that the title was inspired or suggested to me by Kalevi Kul. And at first I was a little afraid because it's like a too big of a thing, Czech theory, whoa. Working on this topic, eventually I find it very, very useful. This book is in Czech, but if you're interested, there is a review by Ekaterina Velmezová in Science Systems Studies, which is in English. So you can get a sort of a big picture. So in this book, my main interest in this book was whether and how it's possible to answer sort of a brief but difficult question. What is semiotics, or more precisely, what is general semiotics in Czechoslovakia and more recently in the Czech Republic? And the main part of my answer I try to offer consists in a certain division or classification that reflects the fact that it is not possible to define semiotics using one or a single definition. So Czech theory is essentially a mixture and has the three main components, as I hope you can see now on the screen. Semiology, philosophy of language, and semiotics. And in most cases throughout the years, they maintained a considerable degree or amount of autonomy. But what is common to them all and thus characteristic of the whole Czech theory is the fact that their sources, with a few exceptions, didn't come from the major semiotic traditions as we know it, meaning Ferdinand Saussure or Louis Hjelmslev or Charles Sanders Peirce for the matter. So the first sort of a branch, which I call semiology, is connected in one way or another with the tradition of the Prague Linguistic Circle or Prague School. And so in this context of, or in the case of Czech theory, the term semiology is much more specific than is used more widely. With this approach or branch, there are two main problems. One is sort of a historical or political, and that is that between 1948 and 1989, semiology couldn't be consistently developed due to political and ideological situation in Czechoslovakia, when one small exceptions in the middle of 1960s. This was possible only in the 90s, and this more than 50 years after the members of the Prague School published their most important works. So in simple terms, it can be argued that the restoration of this tradition didn't mean restoration of the old programmatic development of semiology, but rather sort of a shift to historical exploration of when and how the members of the Prague Linguistic Circle works and what and so on. The second and more fundamental problem is that at no point in history of this branch of the semiological branch, the Prague School offered a substantive work on general theory of science. So it didn't attempt to be a general semiotics. Despite undeniable results in the field of aesthetics and poetics and linguistics, there is no work in this semiological tradition of so-called Czech theory that can be described as a contribution to general semiotics. And if you're interested in this, a few weeks ago, I published a paper called Ivo Osolsobě on general semiotics in the Czech tradition, and it sort of summarizes this debate and the main sort of line. So the second branch, I call the philosophy of language, shares with the first one an ideological repressive fate, to say, with the first one. So before 1989, it could only appear sort of sporadically, mostly in the form of shorter informative papers or reports about one or other theory or concept originating from a really widely understood analytical tradition. But of course, there was a complete lack of a consistently critical position. We cannot certainly talk about any establishment or development before 1989 of this line proper. So as with the semiologic line, the situation changed fundamentally after 1989. However, the repayment of the intellectual debt that had arisen in the previous period was accompanied by an inevitable pursuit for a certain autonomy. This meant, among other things, that this line or branch was not explicitly considered semiotic, even though the questions and problems it dealt with were indeed semiotic. So in the third branch or line, which I called semiotic, is a branch that has or had its main source in cybernetics. This cybernetic framework had the advantage on the one hand of not being straightforward target of establishment and suppression. And on the other hand, and unlike semiology, this line of branch had a more general ambitions. For example, one of the most important cybernetic books that originated in Czechoslovakia, called cybernetic modeling by Klír and Valach from 1965 can be still today can be read as a kind of introduction to general semiotics without mentioning the term semiotics in any fundamental way. So, but the most important person of this line or branch can be, of course, considered Ivo Osolsobě, who attempted to transform this cybernetic tradition into explicit general semiotics. Unlike semiology and philosophy of language, however, this line didn't really become a subject of wider interest and further development after 1989. So I guess I have to do it this way. Yeah, can you see the slide with semiotics equals auxiliary science of epistemology?
Yes,
great, thank you. So now I want to present or tell more about the second more narrow context, and that's Osolsobě, general semiotics, and slowly approaching the problem of token models. So Osolsobě defines semiotics or general semiotics as auxiliary science of epistemology, and this definition is really crucial to understand everything that comes next. And this type of effort or science is really interested or studies sort of a specific cognitive setting, as Osolsobě puts it. And he calls this setting or situation a situation of a user without an origin. So the user is one way or another epistemologically interested in this original, but this situation is quite unhappy because the user has no access to this original. So Osolsobě asks what that user can do, and he can do all sorts of things. But on the most general level, he can do he can sort of solve this situation by what he calls modeling, and on the other hand by communication. So the first solution, modeling, is a we can say it's a cognitive substitution that for these epistemological purposes replaces the missing original with its model. And in this case, it is possible to create different types of models based on what aspects of the original the model takes into account. And also there gives a sort of simple list of three, which is modeling or models of behavior, structure, and existence. Now, I think it's appropriate to just make a small comment on the word model and modeling. And Osolsobě finds his inspiration in cybernetics, and he really wants to reject linguistics and, for that matter, the term linguistic sign or sign at all from his theory. So for simplicity's sake, you can think about modeling and models through the terms sign. So the second solution to the situation of a sad user is communication, and we can roughly define it as a cognitive cooperation, meaning that it's an epistemological relationship with another user who can turn this sad or unhappy situation into a happy one by, on the one hand, showing the original to the first user. This is a solution that Osolsobě calls non-sign communication or ostension. And the second solution in this line is that the other user shows the model to the first user. So this is a sort of a general layout of picture. And Osolsobě has devoted his career to various parts of this semiotic layout. And probably the most famous and well-known is his interest in this non-sign communication ostension, especially in connection with theater. Osolsobě, for instance, is the author of the entry on ostension in Thomas Sibiok's Encyclopedic Dictionary of Semiotics, and also his position in discussion about this concept is also illustrated by a pretty recent paper by Remo, who is, I guess, also present here. Less attention has been given to the concept, which falls to the sort of a left side of this layout, and which is not directly apparent from it, and this is the so-called token models. So, now to define what a token model means in Osolsobě's theories, first and foremost important to comment briefly, really briefly, on his conception of type and token, because of the term token model. So, instead of a type, Osolsobě uses the term series and defines it very, or quite loosely, as the production process, standards, conventions, or even the ideal member of the production series, or for the matter, prototype. So in the engineering sense of the word, each series resides in the successful application of a repetitive production process. So in this sense, success means or is succession. So, and token is then simply each individual product of the production series. So, according to Osolsobě and his story, the modeling solution to the problem of the user without the original is based on the principle of similarity. That is, and that's maybe quite surprising, in what Osolsobě calls semantics. He's, of course, aware of a number of problems associated with such an approach, meaning approach through similarity. And he describes it, as truly semantic only the aspects associated with sort of a higher level of abstraction. And he says that in everyday modeling situations, similarity becomes a vague and therefore sort of an unproblematic action that users perform based on their own and often arbitrary chosen decisions. So, but this slide is interesting from another point of view because Osolsobě here defines two extreme poles of modeling situation. On the one hand, it's what he calls minimally iconic existential model. And on the other hand, is the most iconic token model. So now we have a basis for definition of token models, and from the Osolsobě's perspective, we can think about tokens. At least from three angles or three perspectives, so we can see the token as some sort of a original in also a sense of word, and this is a quite happy situation of the original being just present, and this is for instance the situations in a museum where a certain exhibit functions as an original, for example. A personal steam car belonging to Franz Ferdinand Dest, as you can see on the first picture. Another way to look at the token from Osolsobě's perspective is that we can think about token as a sample. So the situation is not so happy as the first one, but also not so sad. So it's a situation of partially present original. We can say it's a sort of a metonymical relation, and because series or type, if you want, is present through one of its parts. So an example would be a situation in a museum where the exhibit functions as a sample of a series, like a single Ford model 1910 for the whole model 1910 series, as you can see in the second picture. And the most specific and maybe most strange situation is the third one, where we are interested in token, not as an original or as a sample, but as a model. So the user is in this case interested in another particular token of the same series. And this situation is what Osolsobě calls token-to-token models. So for instance, as you can see on the slide in the third picture, a particular Ford car, for instance, can serve as a model of a similar car that the user or we or you intends to purchase in the future. So now let me conclude this part with a sort of a sharp dichotomy. So on the one hand, according to Osolsobě, we have what he calls existential models. Existential models represent exclusively existence. And existential modeling has nearly endless possibilities to use all individuals and series as models based on the very minimal similarity between the original and the model. This approach or modeling solution, however, cannot function without a system or convention for or of experience. So the existential model has certain, as Osolsobě puts it, semantic disadvantages, but at the same time, many, many pragmatic advantages. So it is possible to model any non-existent, even absurd and wordless product, action, sound, whatever. Third, in sort of a minor note, Osolsobě argues that the primary purpose of existential modeling is for interpersonal communication and interaction. And for this reason, the main domain of existential modeling is language, as one we can say of the consequences of the most easily accessible models, that is bodily models, body models. On the other hand, we have this idea of token-token models. And token-token model is characteristic in the sense that they are that it is not arbitrary at all. On the contrary, it is a very, very restrictive, especially in terms of similarity. Being of the same series, token-token model simply means maximum adequacy or iconicity with respect to the original, meaning the other token. So the original in this case, another token is a semiotic entity, or it is, we can say it is not a non-semiotic or epistemological neutral entity, but a sort of a complete semiotic product, event or thing. The third sort of characteristics of token models are that they are often pragmatically very inappropriate. So, for instance, if the user has a different token of very, very complex machine, it isn't an epistemological advantage. And this is, of course, because token-to-token models are so-called non-specific models. This means that the primary function of a token is not to model another token. The primary function of a car is not to be exposed as a model. So we can say that the token-to-token model has a low modeling transparency. So there is a permanent tension between its function as an original and its function as a model. So last but not least, token-to-token model can be a key mechanism for developing a series or type. If we don't consider a series and its token as really separate units of different order, which is implicitly suggested by Osolsobě, then token-to-token models are the most important contribution to series or type dynamics. So token-to-token modeling can, for example, be a trial and error method. And in this case, the idea of repeatability is not invariant or mechanical. And token models are example of cognitive use of individual tokens in favor of improving the series. Now I'm gonna move to third part, and I would like to start with a few examples, because the term simulation and in minor way also emulation, they have a number of different uses. So for instance, and I guess you are probably familiar with all three of these examples, it implicitly involves the question of computational power and the likelihood that such power will be used in a specific way in this future, in our future. This is the position of Nick Bostrom in his classical paper, Are You Living in a Computer Simulation, in which he doesn't really pay any particular attention to the term simulation or the definition of the term simulation. From this perspective, in much better position is David Chalmers in his latest book, Reality Plus. And among other things, he offers some sort of classification and overall broader framework for the phenomenon of simulation. For instance, he distinguishes between the mechanical and computer simulation. And the third example is the so-called simulation theory as one of the possible attempts to explain how mind reading works. And in this case, it is not so much a question of computational power or power at all, but rather a way to understand simulation as an imagination or even pretense. So when it comes to emulation, it can be said that the use of this term is less frequent and really, really less stable. So my goal here is certainly not to analyze individual uses in specific domains, nor to criticize individual approaches, but rather to suggest a few lines or axes or aspects or parameters that I think might be useful for defining the terms simulation and emulation more generally. And I call this aspect semiotic because in one sense or another, they are based on Osolsobě layout of general semiotic theory, and unsurprisingly, one of the key elements or the key parameter here is the concept of the token-token model. So you can see these axes or ways of looking at those terms on the screen, hopefully. First being the existence, behavior, and structure. Second, the degree of approximation. The third being time dependency. fourth modal components and environment, and five, existence or non-existence of original and purpose of the modal, and final, six, independency of series and tokens. And I wanna really briefly comment on the six. So the first aspect is what we can call semantic in that specific or Osolsobě's sense of the word semantics and semantics. So, and we can try to distinguish between simulation and emulation based on what aspect of the original is modeled. So one, we can simply say that simulation is a model of behavior, while emulation is a model of a structure in contrast to generally understood verbal signs, which in its radical form can rest solely on modeling of existence. So this is, I guess, pretty not controversial classification and corresponds, for instance, to what you can read in different introductions and dictionaries of computer sciences. The second way of looking at this is the degree of approximation. So it is possible from my perspective, based on Osolsobě's writing and thoughts, to distinguish between simulation and emulation on the assumption that each model is a certain approximation of the original. Then there is obvious difference in performance between the original and its model. This difference is what McGregor calls the credibility gap. And this credibility gap is greater in simulation, while emulation tries to minimize it by bringing the model closer to the original. What that means is that emulation is often a model where some functional part of the model is performed by part of the real system, but also emulation is the model where part of the real system is replaced by a model. So in an extreme case, the entire emulation process or emulation can be this real system. And in this case, we are in exactly the situation of token models. The third way or aspect is time dependency or independency. So since there is a necessary gap between the simulation and the original from the point of view of the object, there is also a gap in terms of time. If we accept that simulation is a model of behavior, then the duration of the behavior of the original and the duration of the behavioral model can be and often are not really identical. For instance, the high speed of flight simulation of a rocket heading to Mars is a key feature of simulation. Without such shortened duration, simulation wouldn't make much sense. Emulation, on the other hand, is executed only in real time because some of its components, or in the extreme case of token models, all of them are shared with the original. So this can be sort of seen more generally, or we can say that the issue of component sharing between the original and the model forms another view, another angle, another semiotic aspect. So in the case of one extreme, the so-called existential models, we can say that the original and the model do not share any components at all. Given the fact that the purpose of an existential model is to model or represent exclusively existence, compositionality principle or compositionality is not a constitutive element of such a modeling mode. In the case of the other extreme, which is token-token model or models, the situation is that the composition is of the model is inevitably corresponds to in structure and function and functioning of its components to the original. So this view ultimately leads to questions about abstraction and idealization in modeling, and the questions of the process of identifying, isolating, or defining the boundaries of the original, or what are we in fact modeling, or what should we model? This problem can be understood more generally as the relationship between the original, its model, and the environment. So simulation is a modeling situation in which the environment of the original is either omitted or the environment and its influence are also simulated to some extent, such as the effect, for instance, of the wind in a flight simulator. Emulation is a modeling situation in which the environment, precisely because some of the components of the model are identical to the original, is either identical to the original or has a sort of a hybrid nature. And in the most extreme case in token-token models, the question, of course, doesn't arise at all, because the functional environment of the original and the model is, for obvious reasons, as identical. So we should consider the role of the environment of the model original. And in terms of sequence, you can see on the screen, simulation, emulation, and token-token model, we can formulate this aspect as a simple proportion. The smaller the so-called credibility gap, the less it is necessary to model the environment of the original as well. Or to put it in another way, the larger the credibility gap, the more it is necessary to think about the role of the environment or to completely neglect its effect in the model. So we are slowly approaching the end. So from the point of view of non-existence or existence of original and purpose of the model, I'm proposing a few different features or characteristics. So speaking about simulation, we can say that simulation is often referentially non-binding, or this is a idea you can find in Jean Baudrillard, in the sense that simulation or to simulate is to feign, to have what one really doesn't have. The second feature is that simulation is a really strong epistemological mechanism that, rather than a strict ontology of the original, requires a stable imaging system or rules. The third is that simulation has an experimental and largely theoretical and abstract nature. It is, in very specific sense, an abductive procedure that exists solely on the borderline between our fixed or old experience and a new idea. This is something that was put forward by Ian McGregor. So simulation is a type of experiment, a way to verify or rebut hypothesis without necessity of testing this hypothesis on the prototype or original. This is idea you can find in Rostislav Pazuchin paper, a contribution to general theory of models. Emulation, on the other hand, is a process that at least to some extent in which we are creating or recreating the original. So emulation is a sort of a substitution mechanism in which the existence of the original is needed, is really obligatory. But at the same time, the original can become somewhat unnecessary. like token model and emulation. It's not a specialized model for this reason. Emulation is less suitable for experimentation because, for instance, some of its parts of the original. So, simulation can be understood on the one hand as a model in a much more stricter sense. For instance, an aircraft simulator or flight simulator cannot replace a real airplane, but allows modeling of an aircraft system that is or cannot be, in fact, used for flying. The primary purpose of the simulation is sort of a cognitive replacement. So, emulation, on the other hand, is more robust, the essence of which lies in sort of an ideal substitution or one-to-one ratio. A particular emulation could be used as a replacement for the whole original system. In this case, it is a token model. And furthermore, emulation could be seen as an improved version of the original. For instance, a Microsoft DOS emulator in Windows doesn't need to be and often is not used solely for the studying the behavior of the original, but it is used the same way as the original itself. So emulation is functionally more complex and can in many ways exceed the strictly modeling purpose. Finally, there is the sixth way of looking at this thing. To this point, I've talked about simulation and emulation as modes of modeling, as different types of models. But sometimes, model and simulation can be distinguished along the line that model is a set of abstract instructions, in fact, a type or series, and while simulation is only its use or activation. So, in fact, it's a token of this model. So, simulation as a token and model as a series or type are relatively autonomous, quite easy to differentiate and hierarchical in the sense that the series is a metaphysical condition of its tokens. The simulation process necessarily stops when modifications are made to the model, and all the features and parameters that affect the simulation are included in the model itself, and therefore are under ideal conditions repeatable. This is in contrast to emulation, which tends to be closer to token models. And emulation doesn't conceptually strictly or even at all differentiate between a token and a series. The decision choices and features do not seem to be completely independent of use. In some respects, they are present in a particular token or in another terminology, we can say that the code and its use blend. So emulation modeling cannot fully rely on a repeatability that would be guaranteed by a sort of a separate type. And in emulation, and that's important, individual events or tokens are less predictable. There are no clear winners, so to say, in this competitive process of emulation. Thus, the robustness of an emulation can seem very simple on the one hand, but on the other hand can strongly suppress its modeling function. I'm really sorry for the time, but this is sort of a last slide. So to conclude, simulation and emulation are modes of modeling. That means that they are semiotic mechanisms, and as such, they are not things. Simulation and emulation in themselves. So the semantics of modeling is presented by Osolsobě with its extreme positions in the form of existential models and token models can quite easily be supplemented by simulation and emulation models. In addition to various aspects of and parameters we can use in describing them, it turns out that the semantics of modeling operate whether strictly separate categories of modeling, but that our epistemological and that means semiotic activities represent rather certain parts of the modeling spectrum, as you can see now on the slide. And I'm really sorry for the time, and I'll stop here. Thank you.
Don't worry, thank you. And yes. So we already have one question in the chat, and I will read it, assuming that the person that wrote it would prefer me to read it. So the question is, if we apply the described theory to cryptocurrencies that are simulations of money, the original, then what are crypto tokens? Simulations of behavior or emulations of structure? I apologize if I applied the theory incorrectly.
Well, thank you. Good question, of course, as this is true for all questions. But I'm really not sure about the first part that cryptocurrencies are simulations of money. They are just bits of information that slowly and often in unpredictable way gain sort of a value. So I guess with cryptocurrencies, it's not really the issue. What the theory that I presented, and it's really 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 based on Ivo Osolsobě's approach, is really only semantics. So so this is a sort of abstract branching, differentiating approach, which not really involves a user, so to speak, the pragmatic of the whole thing, of the situation. So this is why I started my presentation with a worry that this is maybe too much, you know, engineering approach, but in, let's say, broader sense, I guess you can say that if there is a need to answer the question in this type of theory, you can say that well, it's a sort of an existential model, because well, you can really manipulate with it according to some sort of rules, but there is no necessity that there is a sort of a strict referent binding of this I don't know, Ethereum or other cryptocurrencies. So in this way, this will be the sort of a first phase to answer this question, but certainly there will be more to it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Kalevi, please.
So thank you so much. Let me just say a little remark or rather observation what concerns both today's talks. Both actually were about modeling. And in this respect, let me recall the one of definitions of semiotics, what was provided by Yuri Lotman and his colleagues, and that was that semiotics is a study of modeling systems, say. And then moreover, that is what we are doing in semiotics, we are doing modeling of modeling. And here the problems say now are indeed how what kind of modeling is adequate for studying modeling. And what I could observe from Witt's description is that this is rather sort of, in a way, not very processual. So at the same time, what we can also observe is that semiotics is becoming slowly more and more processual. So am I right that this processual aspect of how the modeling is going, so was not so much expressed or say in that approach you with were presenting?
Well, thank you for the question and nice to see you. It's a difficult one because what maybe you've noticed all that I didn't use word synecia or synecology or synecism at all. But in this very specific sense, I guess it appeared on the last slide, which shows that the different types of modeling, existential modeling, simulation, emulation, and so on, token models, are sort of operating on the same basis. But what really changes is the rules governing the sort of semantics or as you put it, adequacy of the model. And this cannot be given following Osolsobě in this semantic approach. This cannot be done. This cannot be done. This can be done only if we look for more pragmatically on this thing. So, and this is something that Osolsobě didn't do really with token models, but that with other things, for instance, in this sort of a communication part. So I would understand my presentation as a sort of a little game that I played with some terms that Osolsobě gives us, but nevertheless, it's from my perspective, it can be fun at least. So thank you. I don't know whether I answered your question.
Yes, I think so. Just emphasizing once again that these both talks today were really about general semiotics in a direct sense, very direct sense.
Thank you, both of you. We don't have too much time, but Jonathan, you have also another question.
Yes, I'll be quick. I thought, well, good question and a comment, but your presentation was thorough enough that you answered the question, so I can reformulate it. But one of the comments I wanted to make quickly was just to mark for myself where I had a thought that it was during your talk. You made a connection for me that I'm going to find useful. I think a lot about simulation. And the distinction between simulation as something that's whose focus is to model some object reality, and emulation as aiming to model the structure or the system itself makes sense. I was thinking about similar to the example you eventually gave, which is gaming software, modeling emulators for modeling old computing systems like Nintendo, or old PlayStation systems, such things. I like the point that the aim there is modeling the system is secondary. Like, you know, they're trying to emulate the system so that you can run the software that you want to run. That's the aim. Yeah. It's a functional aim. And it doesn't, at some point, like, it only is sticking to emulating the system to the degree that it helps you with that more immediate result, and eventually can move beyond it. Like, you know, like old Nintendo emulators involve include like save states and quick starts and mechanisms in games that sometimes didn't have them initially as quality of life features. So at that point, you know, the goal is actually to move beyond emulating the initial system or structure, because the real aim is to run the software, and this helps you do that better. So I thought that was interesting, because simulation is aiming to model some reality as well as possible, or and then in the case of emulation, it's a secondary thing. I thought that was really useful and really cool insight. I'm gonna think about it a lot, and I just wanted to like mention that your talk is where I thought like I had that connection. So.
Yeah, Jonathan, thank you.
And my question was, My question was, you mentioned MS-DOS. That's I was going to ask if you had some models in mind that you were thinking of, and you gave MS-DOS. And if you have some others that you're thinking about, yeah. I would like to hear them. That's it.
I would probably think about different game engines or different old machines that you can sort of emulate in the modern computers. Because and that's a really interesting question, because, well, you can define emulation in the way I sort of did. That's a more abstract, general. But when it comes to our world, what is emulators? That's just things that that we use to emulate or model or represent earlier version of operating system or some sort of operating system on the new one. So there are certainly we can also in this respect we can say that that the original and the model in the sense is share some components. In the more general sense, like it's a computer, so it has a sort of a hard drive and so on and stuff like that. But on the other hand, your comment or remark was perfect, because of course this is emulation is much closer from the point of view I see it to these token models. And as I try to emphasize, token models are like a secondary models, and they are only models in under very specific conditions. It's not it's you can use it that way, but it's not its primary use or primary function. So yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. And so maybe we have time for one more short question, if there is. Do we have one?
Hello.
Yeah.
Excellent presentation. I wonder. I'm just. It's a shot in the dark, but it seems like it. What was Osolsobě's relationship to formalism?
Well, that's a big one. Can you be more specific about what you mean by formalism?
Let's say Russian formalism.
Oh, Russian formalism. Osolsobě's case, if we want to sort of differentiate between it, I don't think he would say that his sources for his theory comes from this, but But well, in a more general sense or way, well, why not? I'm sorry, I don't see, I can't see any direct connection between this.
You would consider his approach to be formalistic in a way?
Yeah, it is. But just in this one, like a really, really, really small segment. So, because from the he has many great papers on theater and on theater communication, and it's like a less formal. But as you can see, I guess this formalism comes from the cybernetic tradition. If you look through the cybernetic modeling. This is a book Osolsobě mentioned quite often. So, and he really, really loved it. So I guess this is the source more likely than Vladimir Prokofiev.
Sure. The question was not so much about Russian formalism, but just formalism per se. And my question, okay. I'm trying to encourage is, I guess, the question about general semiotics. And is the basis of general semiotics going to possess this element of formalism, right?
Yeah, that's true. Because I want to frame my presentation with this very specific questions. Maybe I wasn't specific enough, because the main question of the book was really what is semiotics, and what I saw. During the work on the book was the answer was more or less the same. Well, we don't know, or it's this or that. So the answer to what is general semiotics, there's only one proper answer for the Czech tradition, which is Hjelmslev, the Sassure, Charles Peirce excluded. No influence on what happened here during like the second half of the 20th century. So, and the only answer is the cybernetic one. So, my presentation was a sort of a follow up on what Josh said two weeks ago, and he made a small remark about cybernetic heritage. And well, that's it. We can say that now the cybernetic tradition of what I call Czech theory is that. So
we may have some further discussion need to be had about the relationship between semiology and cybernetics and which one takes priority, yeah. But they share this element of formalism, definitely. And this commitment to formalism is sort of, well, usually at least, at the exclusion of process, right? Process is something outside of the descriptive system. So this is to Kalevi's question, I guess.
Yeah, I think it's just much more to it. And I'm really eager to talk to you about this problem more once we see in a few weeks. So.
What I wanted to say also, thank you for your most excellent presentation. I think it was a fabulous way to end this. Not to close down the comments though, I think maybe Josh might want to respond to that last comment. But.
Well, only to say that I absolutely look forward to those conversations. It's definitely been the comparison of process to formalism. I think that'll be a much more involved and rich. That's a rich seed for future conversations for sure.
I have sort of a comment about that because. Well, I don't know. I have the impression that at least a part of Czech theory related to linguistics, it can also be labeled as functionalist. And I think that from that side, there might be some way of tackling process that can be still in a way formalistic, but Yeah, I don't know. I think that's very interesting, actually. Like, because so where to put this functionalist thing? That I mean, there were all these discussions about teleology and these things in the Prague linguistic circle. So where does that fall in this? I think that's very nice, and indeed I agree with Tyler that this was a very nice way to finish this series. Yes. And well, I don't know if there are some more questions or because if not,
if the time for questions is over, then just let me say many thanks to Israel and his colleagues who are organizing and have organized this series of semiosalongs, because this is just one of important means to develop semiotics, and we should develop it. So, and I hope that the next semester it will go on in that very international way, and many of us will continue this discussions face to face in Olomouc in the end of June.
Yes, thank you. Indeed, I really cannot wait to. I know that a lot of us will be there, and I think it's going to be really a great time. And thank you very much, Kalevi. But really, I also want to thank Tyler and Ludmila and Ellie, who is sometimes, I think she was there, but maybe not, because they have also been quite integral part of the organization and the support and everything. So yeah, thank you. And of course, we will continue doing this for next semester. So very soon we will let you know. So very briefly, there is a digital hand raised. So, and I think it's Armando. So Armando, if you can be brief with your comment or question.
Hello, can you listen to me?
Yes.
Okay, well, I just wanted to ask if you have, what are the main ideas that you took as a base to develop this model? I mean, I find it very useful, and I'm working on something related. So I just want to know what was the base of your, idea to develop this, just like that. And thank you very much. Very interesting. I hope you all have a great day.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Well, I guess that really, really depends on the pragmatic of the things, meaning that what you wanna do with that. I guess at least for me, the idea is this token model, which is really interesting thing to look at. And some sort of an angle and you can shift your attention or attention on different definitions along the axis of this token model. So and the six aspects or features of this simulation emulation dichotomy is a really sort of a Rortian approach. So it's not really a strict way. It's not a really consistent set of features. It's just a way to say, hey, just we can look on this problem this way or that way. So in this final part of my presentation, I will be not so really interested in development as a whole, but maybe from a portion of a segment or aspect or a term or an idea that can be good as well on its own. So.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I thought about something like that, but anyway, I wanted to make sure.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, so very good. So now, since we are already a bit over our time, and many questions have been asked, I'm sure that many questions are left unasked. I personally have lots of them, but I'm just hoping, waiting until I meet some of you in the Czech Republic soon, and then we will have some discussions. So thank you very much again for joining us, and thank you for coming to this series, and we will see you next semester. So we have already a preliminary topic for next semester, Semiosalong, which will be the semiotics of time and space. But everything is still we are still working on everything, but soon we will let you know what will happen. And also keep your eyes open for the summer, because maybe something will happen. But if not, in next autumn, for sure, there will be the next Semiosalong series. So yes, thanks again. And have a nice evening or a nice afternoon, wherever you are. So thank you. And see you.